Our Father, I think there's a tremendous amount of wisdom in people's lives when they choose to invest their life in the things that have eternal consequences. And Lord, I'm grateful that you have given me as a Christian, as a pastor, as a preacher, a place to serve and invest in eternity. I thank you for Beck and Terry and working alongside them. And Lord, how I pray that you'll continue to bless, that you'll continue to do all that needs to be done to reach people with the gospel. I pray for today. I don't know what you might have in store, but I know that you do. And we just want to be a part of it. And we'll thank you for it in Christ's name. Amen and amen. All righty, I was looking around to see if we have any first-time visitors. And the only way we know to do this is ask you to do this, to raise a hand. Anybody here today for the very first time, never been here before? And all right, back here on the back. Good, girls. We're glad to have you. Thank you so much. That distinguished-looking gentleman there has got a gift for you, and we appreciate so much. There's a visitor's card in that packet, and if you'll fill it out and drop an offering plate in a few minutes, we'd appreciate it so much.
Stand. Thank you, Lord. just want to thank you, Lord, for everything you've done for me.
Stand with us. We continue to sing today. I hope you do this every day of your life. You count your blessings. There are so many to count. God does so many things for us every day of our life. You sing this with us this morning as a way of praise and honoring Him.
When upon life fills you a tempest falls, when you are discouraged, thinking all is lost, count your many blessings, thank them one by one, and it will surprise you what the Lord has done. Count your blessings, thank them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God has done. Conflict, whether great or small, do not be discouraged, God is over all. Count your many blessings, angels will attend, help and comfort give you to your journey's end. Count your blessings, thank them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God hath done.
So good to all of us. All righty, what a mighty God we serve, and He is. Amen. Y'all need to perk up a little bit this morning, you know? Get a little Pentecostal. Choir, help me just a little bit. Y'all need to perk up a little bit this morning. Get a little Pentecostal. Amen. Well, three of them did, anyhow. Here we go.
What a mighty God we serve. What mighty God we serve. Angels bow before Him.
Come a day in glory that you're going to bend over, you're going to raise your hands, and you're going to shout the victory. I can guarantee you what a day that will be. Amen, choir. What a day that will be. Here we go.
What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see, and I look
Sunday school class this morning that in a lot of churches nowadays, there's a void of talking about, preaching about, and teaching about the return of Christ. For whatever reason, I can't give you the exact reason, you know, unless people just are content with what they got here. But one way or the other, I'm on the downhill side of this thing being in eternity, like most of y'all, or some of y'all. But I'm going to put it like that. Some of y'all are, okay? But it's going to be an exciting day when we see him face to face.
Yeah.
But Robert, we'll be able to stand and shout the victory.
Yeah.
Think about that for just a minute. What a day that will be when you see your loved ones again. Some of y'all need to get a little bit excited about stuff in life, you know? You remember the honeymoon? You remember the honeymoon? What? You can't hear. I guess it didn't ring bell, did it? Well, let's go ahead and sing. Let's get over that. Here we go. One more time, then we'll shake hands.
What a day that will be.
Oh,
I think so many times down through history, people have asked the question, why would God, in the form of Jesus Christ, leave the splendor of heaven, all the things that he had in heaven? Why would he come to this earth, be born with a human body, be born in a feed trough? You know, we hear the story of Christmas told all the time, and we use the word manger to make it sound better. It was a feed trough. And, you know, lived a human existence here on this earth for 33 years, never sinned. The Bible says everything that you and I have dealt with in life that Christ did while he was here. Temptation, pain, sadness, all those things. And people still ask the question, why did he do that? He didn't have to. Why did he do that? This song answers that. It was just love. He loved us. Love alone. That's what this song says. You listen to the words, it'll bless you today.
And all the angels worshipped at his feet. But a lowly dusty manger was where he chose to be, wrapped in rags of true humility.
All the poor and hungry.
Stand with us. We continue to sing. We'll let our ushers come in and take today's offering. Let our choir be seated. He touched me. I hope he's touched your life in an eternal way this morning. You sing it with us while our choir goes down.
Shackled by a heavy burden, neath the load of guilt and shame, then the hand of Jesus touched me, and
and doing this. Wayne, come on up here. Wayne's never done this before, and I'm hoping he's going to brag on the preacher, but he's not.
No, that ain't going to happen. I'm not a speaker, but I just felt like God impressed upon me. Tonight we have the 5:30, I think, meeting for Awana. And if you don't have a ministry, I'd encourage you to think about it. You'll get far more out of it than you'll ever put in. I can't sing, I can't preach, but I can love a child, and you can too. Think about it.
Good job. And he can't sing, he really can't. But he can love kids. He's been doing it for a number of years. Father, we thank you, Lord, for the privilege to serve you. We thank you, Lord, for the privilege of being faithful in our giving, not just giving, but Lord, giving of ourselves. That's so much more valuable than dollars and cents. God, we appreciate people's willingness to be faithful so that we can have a Awana program, so kids can hear the Word of God, so kids can understand the gospel, so kids can go to heaven. Lord, the Bible says you have to use people in order to make these things happen. And I appreciate Wayne's willingness to say that. In Christ's name, amen.
Thank you, gentlemen. Jackson's going to come and sing for us this morning a song that answers a question, that it truly does matter to God what we do with our lives. He went to the trouble to die for us and save us, and he expects something in return. He expects that we love him, that we honor his word, and that we do lots of things But even if we don't, he still loves us. He still died for us. It does matter to him. You listen as she sings this song.
You down and you feel more broken than whole. When the wounds go deeper than words and you can't tell a soul. I may not know what you're going through and may not be able to. He wants to share the burdens you bear, whisper peace when the world is shattered. If it's your greatest joy or your deepest pain or you're really needing an answer, if it matters to you, it matters to the Master. Friend, do you think that the maker and giver of life is far too busy to care about your troubles and strife? Sees the sparrow that falls to the ground, and he hears the tears that don't make a sound. If you only knew how precious you are in his sight. If it matters to you, it matters to the Master. To share the burdens you bear, whisper peace when your world gets shattered. If it's your greatest joy or your deepest pain or you're really needing an answer, if it matters to you, it matters to the Master. Joy or your deepest pain, and you're really needing an answer. If it matters to you, it doesn't only matter to you. If it matters to you, it matters to the Master.
So much. I'll get to my text here in just a minute, so don't think that I have forgotten it. I promise you I haven't. I'm going to pray, and I want you to listen carefully. I've been doing this little series of words in Scripture, different words, and I'll explain more about it in just a minute. But I don't know if you've picked up on it. I pray that you have, that it's build, one word builds on another, one another, 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 and such as that. And the word that I'm going to deal with this morning when we're talking about sanctification, it's vitally important for you for this particular reason. Because if what I'm going to talk about this morning for just a few minutes, if this is not true in your life, then the rest of it's not. You can go through all the motions you want, you know, in trying to convince yourself that that you're truly born again. And I'm not trying to cause anybody whatsoever to doubt their salvation at all. I promise you I'm not. But if sanctification is not true in your life, if your life is not being set apart for God's glory, if your life is not being set apart to strive for Christ-likeness and holiness in your life, and I'm not trying to be a holy roller and all that, that's not what I'm saying, but if you're not setting your life apart for the glory of God, then I would encourage you to go back and search the other words that we've talked about. Because you can go through all of this, you can jump through all these hoops that you want to. You say, well, how do you know that's true, preacher? Because I was one of them. My wife was one of them. We know that for certain. Satan's doing everything within his power to convince you and convince me that everything's okay between you and God as long as you sit in a blue chair, as long as you're sincere, as long as you mean well and trying hard and work hard and, you know, and maybe even been baptized and all that stuff. But I believe that the Word of God teaches us that there is evidence in our lives that we have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Evidence that's true. And we ought to be able to recognize that. Father, I pray for these few minutes that we'll take, Lord, that first of all, that you'll be glorified above everything else. And I pray that people's hearts could be settled about their salvation, that they would see the need, maybe not only in their life, but in the life of someone that they love, someone that's dear to them. And Lord, I just pray that people would understand the truth of sanctification being set apart for you. And Lord, it doesn't mean that we live a perfect life, but it just does mean that we're progressing towards Christ's likeness, and we have a heart to be like Jesus. And I pray that you'll help us this morning in all that we do and all that we may say. In Christ's name, amen and amen. We've been considering, I think, some really great words pertaining to the gospel. Some great words that you find throughout Scripture that I'm not saying that you ought to be able as a, and I'm certainly no theologian, but you're not be able as a theologian to stand up and give all of the background for it and all of the Greek texts and all that kind of stuff. That's not what I mean. But I think it's some words that we've been considering that you need to be able to have a handle on somewhat. Words that would be good for believers to have somewhat of an understanding of. For instance, we started, the very first word that we looked at was the word conviction. The word conviction means to convince someone. It literally has the idea of shining a light on something. That a person, in order to become a believer in Jesus Christ, they must be convicted of something, convicted of their sin. And God will shine a light, so to speak, by the power of the Spirit of God in your life and my life to show us that we have a need for Christ. Because it's important that you understand, and I understand, you don't get saved just when you take a notion to. Right. The Bible talks about that Christ seeks us out to seek and to save that which was lost. People don't just say, well, maybe this would be a good day or maybe next week. No, when God's dealing with you, when God convicts you, when God shows you in your life that there's a need for salvation, that would be the time to listen to what he's got to say. To convince a person of their unbelief of who Christ is and what Christ did for them and did for all mankind. To convince you of that. Second word we looked at was the word repentance. The word repentance means to change your mind about and turn from an unbelief in faith in Christ to a belief in Christ. To repent. And we use the illustration, we turn from our unbelief about Christ, and we turn to Jesus Christ. We don't turn from Christ to the church. We don't turn from Christ to good works, to trying hard, because that's what Christ wants. Christ wants me to work hard. Christ wants me to try hard. Christ wants me to mean well and all that stuff. No, you turn from your unbelief. You repent, turn from that, and you turn to the person of Jesus Christ. There, you know, a lot of people mix up the word regret and repentance. When somebody regrets something, they may regret they got caught. I regret I got caught. You don't repent you got caught. You regret you got caught. Or, you know, you regret that you caused trouble or whatever it may be. No, that's not the same as repentance, to repent, to turn from. So a person is convicted because of their conviction. They repent of their sin. And then by faith, that was the third word that we considered, is faith. Our faith in Christ means to trust totally and completely in something or someone. And spiritually speaking, we trust in or put our total and absolute faith in the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. We don't put it in the church. We don't put it in the baptistry. We don't put our faith in the preacher. We don't put our faith in how hard we work or how sincere we are, or I've got a granny that's a Christian, and the list could go on. No, our faith must be in the person and the finished work of Christ. True saving faith is made evidence by the life that we live. Go with me in just a minute. Go to the book of James for just a second. James chapter 2. When we talk about faith, faith will produce fruit. And a lot of people, our lives as Christians, our lives as believers in Jesus Christ, we have one purpose in life. I know this is going to sound silly, but it's not. Our whole purpose as Christians is to produce fruit. That's what God's called us to do. Go to John chapter 15 sometime and read that, study it. God's called you and I to produce fruit. There's a lot of different kinds of fruit. We're not going to get into that, but that's what God's called us to do. But the kind of faith that God gives us in order to be saved is a living faith, not a dead faith. Look, if you would, at James chapter 2. Look, first of all, at verse 14. What doth it profit a man? Prophet, my brethren, though a man say he hath faith and hath not works, can faith save him? Now, he's not saying that we are saved by works. He's simply saying that our faith, true saving faith, is made evidence by the works that we do. We're not saved by certain things that we do, but by our faith in Christ. But drop down in James 2, look at verse 17. Even so, faith, if it hath not works, is dead, being alone. Yea, a man may say, thou hast faith, and I have works. Show me thy faith without thy works, and I will show thee my faith by my works. Thou believest that there is one God, thou doest well. The devils or the demons also believe and tremble. But will thou know, O vain man, that faith without works is dead? In other words, you may say, I got faith, preacher. Well, that's good, but does your faith produce something in your life? Is there evidence of a relationship with Jesus Christ? That's the kind of saving faith that James is talking about there. And then the next word after that we looked at was the word regeneration. Talked about or the new birth, whichever one you want to call it. Without being born again, there can be no salvation. Jesus was talking in John chapter 3, and he talked to the religious leader. His name was Nicodemus, and he said to Nicodemus in verse 3 and verse 5, he said, Nicodemus, you must be born again. You must be born again. Now, each of these words will lead to salvation. They progressively lead to salvation. You're convicted. You repent, you put your faith in, and you're born again and such as that. But what I want to consider this morning is the end result of each of those. What is the result of my salvation? You know, how are people going to know that I'm saved? There is a, and the word is sanctification. They're going to throw a definition of sanctification up there. You may want to write that in a fly leaf of your Bible somewhere. But sanctification is simply the gracious work of God in setting the believer apart for himself and for service in the world in which we live. The word sanctified literally means to be set apart. Okay? God sets you apart, but God sets you apart for a reason. Basically, sanctification comes in three parts. And that's what I'm going to consider for just a minute, okay? But, you know, those white blank pages that's in your Bible, that's what words like that are for. Write them down in that, okay? Sanctification. But basically, sanctification has three parts. Part one is positional sanctification. Part two is practical sanctification. Part three is perfect sanctification. And I'm going to take just a minute and look at those, okay? So let's consider, first of all, positional sanctification, a person's position. Positional sanctification means that in Christ we've been set apart to belong to God and to serve the Lord. You know, God didn't suffer and die on the cross just so that we could go to heaven. Christ didn't go through all that he went through, all of the suffering that it talks about in the book of Isaiah, all of the suffering that you read about in the Gospels, all of the crown that they placed on his head, all of the things that he dealt with just so you could go to heaven. He could take you to heaven without doing that. He paid the price that you and I owed. There had to be a sacrifice offered, and he was the sacrifice, the only sacrifice that God the Father was willing to accept, plain and simple. Our lives as believers, the Bible talks about, are to be set apart so that he might be glorified by the lives that we live. Look, if you would, go to 1 Corinthians for just a second. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, look at verse 2. In verse 2, he talks about that we have been called by God to be set apart and holy for God's use and for God's glory. Now, listen carefully what I'm getting ready to say. God didn't just set apart the preacher. God didn't just set apart the preacher's wife or the song leader or the leadership of the church. God had set apart every born-again, blood-bought believer to serve him. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 2. Unto the church of God, which is at Corinth, to them that are sanctified in Christ Jesus, called to be saints, with all that in every place call upon the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, both theirs and ours. You say, well, preacher, why did you particularly pick that particular verse? Well, if you'll notice, he says they called to be saints with all. Every brother or sister in Christ is not going to dot their I's and cross their T's like you and I do. And there's a reason I'm saying this, okay? We may have some people come into our church sometime that may not look like us. They may not have the same color skin as we do. They may have eyes that's a little bit different shape than what our eyes may be. And the list could go on as far as how people may differ from us. But listen to me, guys. They love God, and they're saved as much as you are and I am. Doesn't make one iota of difference. And that's what he's trying to convey. And you have to understand some things about the church at Corinth, okay? If you'll notice, he called every believer that was in Christ, black, white, short, tall, whatever it may be. Now, you could hardly call the people at Corinth godly people. There was a reason that Paul was writing this letter to the church or the believers at Corinth. Some of the people at Corinth were getting drunk. They were involved in immorality. They were involved in suing one another, and the list goes on with all the stuff. They were abusing spiritual gifts. It wasn't your ideal church, put it like that. But notice again what Paul says in verse 2. Unto the church of God, which is at Corinth, to them that are sanctified in Christ Jesus. Saved. Perfect? No. Need of help? You bet you. Had problems all through the church. But they were sanctified. They were in the process, progressing. We'll get that in just a minute. Progressive sanctification. But I'm talking about they were in a positional sanctification. They were in Christ. Perfect? No. Got problems? Tons of them. But the moment that they put their faith and trust in Jesus Christ, and they knew that they had repented of their sins, they knew that they had been convicted of their sin, they repented, they turned to Christ by faith, and God began to work in their hearts and lives. They were in Christ. It's just like our church this morning. I am so glad I don't know what you're thinking. You have no idea how proud I am. Because if I knew what you was thinking, I'd probably fold my Bible and walk out that door and say, you bunch of heretics, you bunch of heathens. I'm here trying to preach and tell you about Jesus, and you're worried about the roast. You're worried about whether you're going to get first in line ahead of the Methodists. The list could go on. My point is just simply this, folks. The church at Corinth was not your ideal church, but they were in Christ, positionally speaking. They knew that they had a relationship with Christ. Paul addressed them as those that are sanctified, set apart for God's glory. That's called positional sanctification. Listen carefully. Positional sanctification never changes. Once you're in Christ, you're there. You may act like a heathen, but you're in Christ. Okay? Let me show you the second thing. Practical, another way to say the same thing, is not only practical, but progressive sanctification. This has to do with our everyday living, how we live our life out. You remember how Christ prayed in John 17:17? He said, sanctify them by the truth. Thy word is truth. Now, since we have a holy position in Christ, we should live up to about who we are. I read one preacher said it like this. It's one thing for sin to live in us, but it's another for us to live in sin. And I think that's exactly right. We can't help having our old nature, our old humanness. But God's given us a new nature, and this new nature enables us to live a holy life. Let me say that again. When I got saved, the Bible says that I received a brand new nature come within me. The Spirit of God came within me. And that nature that's within me now, the Spirit of God that dwells within me now, will enable me to live in such a way, set apart for God's glory, to bring honor and glory to Christ. That's what God saved me to do. Take your Bible, go to the right if you're in 1 Corinthians, go to 2 Corinthians chapter 7. Look, if you would, at verse 1. And you ought to put stars by this verse, okay? 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 1. Having therefore these promises, dearly beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. Two words you need to underline there. The word flesh and the word spirit. Okay? I'll explain here in just a minute. Let me read the verse again. Having therefore these promises. What promises? Back in chapter 6, I'll show in a second. Having therefore these promises, dearly beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and the spirit. There are two aspects of sin. And there are sins of the flesh and there are sins of the spirit. Now, let me see if I can explain this to you. Keep your finger there, but go back with me, if you would, to the left, to the book of Luke. Luke chapter 15, very familiar story. Most of you know it. Luke 15, the story of the prodigal son. We all know how, what took place in his life, okay? And you find in Luke 15 a good illustration of the sin of the flesh and the sin of the spirit. In Luke chapter 15, the prodigal, which was the younger of the son, was guilty of the sin of the flesh. Look at verse 12. And the younger of them said to his father, "Father, give me the portion of goods that falleth to me." And he divided them unto his living. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey and went into a far country, and there wasted his substance with riotous living. In other words, this young fellow got weary of living at home. He said, "God, give me what I deserve." Basically, what he was saying to his daddy, he said, "Dad, I don't care if you're dead. I just want my inheritance, and I want it now, because I'm going to go out and I'm going to party. I'm going to find me some loose women, and I'm going to find as many of them as I can. And I'm going to party. You cannot imagine how I'm going to party." We all know the story of all that took place. How he regretted, eventually regretted what he did. He came back to the father received him, and so on and so forth. Okay? But he basically wished, that's what he was trying to convey there, before he went out and lived in his immorality, that his father was dead. But there's another part of the story. That's the sin of the flesh. But there's another part of the story. If you'll look at verse 25, this is the sin of the spirit. Luke 15, verse 25. "Now the elder son," or the older brother, "was in the field, and as he came and drew nigh to the house, he heard music and dancing, and he called one of the servants and asked him what these things meant. And he said unto him, 'Thy brother is come, and thy father has killed the fatted calf, because he has received him safe and sound.' And he was angry." Now picture the story here for just a minute. This young brother went out and spent everything that he had in his loose living. After time, he came back. The older brother's out in the field, breaking his back, trying to keep the farm together. And his dad, every day, was going out looking for the younger son to come home. And finally, the younger son came home, and the father said, "Hey, kill the fatted calf. Let's have a party. The younger boy's home. This is great." Well, here comes home the older brother. And he said, "What's going on?" He said, "Your younger brother's home, and dad's having a time. We're having a meal and a banquet, and this is wonderful." And the older brother says, "You are kidding me." And he says there in verse 28, "And he was angry." That's called the sin of the spirit. You say, "Well, why are you giving these illustrations?" Well, when we talk about progressive sanctification, you could be guilty of the sin of the flesh or the sin of the spirit. You may not be out partying. You may not be out doing things in that respect that others are doing. But you're just as guilty because of your anger or your bitterness or your unforgiveness. You're not willing to forgive somebody. Or maybe you're full of pride. Nobody can see the sin that you're doing but God. But nonetheless, it's there. I can give you another illustration. If you remember the story of David, and David and Bathsheba, David was guilty of the sin of the flesh. He saw Bathsheba. We know the story of how they had relations and so on and so forth. But we know later on that David was also guilty of the sin of the spirit. He counted, he told his men, he said, "I want you to go out and I want you to count all of the men that's in the tribes. Because look what I have built. Look what I've got." And it was a sin of pride. There are sins, listen carefully, there are sins of action, meaning the flesh, and there's sins of attitude, meaning the sins of the spirit. Everything the Bible has to say about the flesh, anytime it talks about the flesh, it's always negative. Always. It's John 6:63 says this: it is the spirit that quickeneth, but the flesh that profiteth nothing. Point being is simply this: out of the heart of man, the old nature comes and sorts through evil, lying and lust and things such as that. That wrecks our lives. I'm trying to go somewhere with this that y'all understand that you can be wrapped up in the sins that you're committing. You're not going to beat yourself up because you're saying, I'm not doing those sins of the flesh. I don't do that. I don't have that struggle, whatever it may be. But you may be guilty of those things in your life. You've got unforgiveness towards someone. You've got bitterness towards someone. Or you're full of pride, or whatever it may be. The Bible talks a great deal about sin. Matter, you go to the book of Galatians chapter 5, begin with verse 19. It talks about 17 different sins that we could commit. Go to the book of Romans. Romans chapter 1, begin with verse 19, verse 2, verse 32. It talks about 24 different sins are mentioned. My point is simply this, guys. The sins of the Spirit, you may not be guilty of drunkenness and adultery and gluttony and laziness, but how about stubbornness? How about criticism? You know, how about pride? You may not be the prodigal son, but you may be like the older brother. So much more could be said from 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 1, pertaining to our sanctification. Look at it again, if you don't mind. It's a powerful, powerful verse, I think, that we all need to understand and get down in our thinking. Because if we don't understand what's going on in our hearts and lives, you and I are never going to be able to fix what's broke. Look at it again. Go back to 2 Corinthians 7. Having therefore these promises, dearly beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. Perfecting sanctification is what he's trying to convey here. How important it is. The promises that he's referring to go back to what you find in chapter 6, begin with verse 14. But let me see if I can wrap this message up with Paul's words. If you'll look at 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Look at verse 17 for just a minute. 2 Corinthians 5, verse 17. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things have become new. And all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and hath given to us the ministry of reconciliation. It's important. You ought to mark those two verses, okay? God has no need to be reconciled to you and I. But the Bible does say that we have a need to be reconciled to him. Look what he says in verse 20. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ. As though God did beseech you by us, we pray you in Christ's stead, be ye reconciled to God. My point is simply this: since Jesus no longer walks this earth in the flesh, you and I are now his ambassadors. Now stay with me, and I'm almost finished, okay? God saved us. God has sanctified us, set us apart as believers in him, as ambassadors for him. You and I are Christ's ambassadors. When you walk out those doors, you are an ambassador for the Lord Jesus. We speak on his behalf to those that don't know him. Christians are the head. They're the mind of Christ. They're the hands that do the work of Christ. They're the heart to show and demonstrate the love of Christ. And the message of every ambassador is simply this: to be reconciled to God. I think a lot of people miss the whole concept of what Christianity is all about. And what I mean by that is simply this: it's important and imperative that you and I understand that back in the very beginning, in the Garden of Eden, we were separated from God because of sin. The Bible says that you and I were conceived in sin. So we were born sinners. We were born separated from God. And the Bible says that we need to be reconciled, brought back to God. And Jesus Christ, by dying upon the cross and paying the price for your sin and my sin, is that reconciliation that brings it back. And by putting our faith and trust in the finished work of Christ, we can be reconciled to God the Father. Christ's job, as far as his sacrifice upon the cross of Calvary, was to reconcile you and me to God the Father. Amen. That's what it's all about. And now that I have been reconciled to God the Father, I have become an ambassador for Jesus Christ. And an ambassador sets himself apart from the world that he's in and represents the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. That's who we represent. That's sanctification. Progressive sanctification, being set apart for God's glory. Has to do with our everyday life. What God wants us to do. Let me give you the last point. Perfect sanctification. Look at 1 John chapter 3 and verse 2. And then I'll wrap it up. 1 John chapter 3 and verse 2. Beloved, now are we the sons of God. And it doth not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him. For we shall see him as he is. That simply means this. At the return of Christ, we shall somehow be transformed into the likeness of the Lord Jesus. Plain and simple. Positional sanctification, I'm in Christ. That's not going to change. Progressive sanctification, I'm in the process of becoming more Christ-like in my life. God uses the Word of God. That's the reason I have a problem with people, and I know this ain't going to set well with some of you, but that's okay. I have a problem with people that's not interested in learning the Word of God, not being exposed to the Word of God in the house of God, around the people of God. You say, why? Because the more you know about Christ, the more you're going to be like Christ. And the less you know about Christ, the less you're going to be like Christ. And the less you're like Christ, the less of an impact that you're going to have on the lives of other people. The more I can become like Christ, the more I know the mind of Christ, which is the Word of God, the more impact I'm going to have on the life of other people. I set myself apart for God's glory. I have a heart to do that, but you have to make a choice to do that. If you say, well, I'm not interested in learning the Word of God, I'll give him Sunday morning, I'll give him an hour out of 168 hours a week, I'll give him an hour, but I expect him, I expect him to show up when my child's sick. I expect him to come through when I'm going through a trial or a tribulation. He better show up. But I'm not going to give him, but, you know, when it's convenient, I'll show up. But otherwise, he better show up. Let me tell you something, guys. God is not a genie in a jar. You don't just rub the jar when you take a notion to him and say, God, you show up. It just don't work that way. You've got to make a decision. Now that you've been positionally set apart for God's glory, what you're going to do with a life that God's given you to live? We all have one. You can either invest it or you can waste it. I told my class this morning, I said, you know, you can decide, you can either invest in what is eternal or what's temporary. Choice is yours. People give their entire lives to get one more toy, one more thing. When all is said and done, you're going to leave it all. You're not taking one blessed thing with you. Why not invest it now for there? That is, watch this, that is if you believe this. I believe it. I believe he's coming back. And I believe he's coming back soon. The next thing on God's calendar is the rapture of the church. You know what that word rapture means? It means to be snatched. He's going to snatch us out of this mess that we're in. I'm in the snatching mood. I wish you'd come on and snatch on, brother. Snatch on. But either way, I win. Either way. Father, Lord, thank you for the salvation that we enjoy in our relationship with you. Not because I'm a church member. Not because I'm sincere and I'm trying hard. Not because I'm a Baptist. Not because I'm a preacher. I'm on my way to heaven because I saw myself as a sinner in need of a Savior. I repented of my sin one day, turned from my sin, and turned to Jesus Christ. I didn't turn to the church. I didn't turn to the baptism. I didn't turn to any of that. I turned to the person of Jesus Christ. The Bible says that the Spirit of God came and took up residence in me so that I now, in turn, can make a difference in the lives of other people by the life that I live, by the fruit that I produce, by my willingness to make a difference. There are people in this room this morning that's got sons and daughters, grandchildren, friends, whatever it may be. They want to think with every fiber of their being that they're going to go to heaven when they die. But there's no evidence whatsoever that they have a relationship with Christ. None. None. Oh yeah, when they were in vacation Bible school, they said that little prayer, everything's okay. None. The Bible says that we will bear fruit if we know Christ is Savior. I didn't write that. The Word of God said that. Our lives will be different. My prayer this morning, Lord, is if there's anybody in this room that's got a cause to doubt their salvation, that they'll leave their seat in just a minute and either come to me or someone else up here that we can help them to know how to know Christ as Savior. I pray for truly born-again believers, just like the people at Corinth. That church was a mess. But according to you, Lord, they were in you positionally. They knew Christ as Savior, but they weren't living like it. And I pray, and God, I'm glad to know that finally they did get things squared away. But there may be some in here that's got some things going on in their life that's, it's not the sin of the flesh, but the sin of the spirit. They're angry. They haven't forgiven someone. Nobody knows about what's going on in their life but you and them. God, they need to bring it to this altar and leave it there and ask you to fill them with your spirit to make a difference in the lives of others. And then lastly, Lord, there may be some that need a church home and they prayed about it and with all their heart, they know this is where they ought to be. God, we'll thank you for what you'll do. We've done our best to tell them. In Christ's name, amen.